the Dutch coast. A September afternoon. In the far distance, the cranes of Rotterdam Harbor. Right in front of us, a wind-driven field of powerful sea waves, breaking over the sandbanks and pounding the sandy beach. These are highly complicated, non-linear phenomena. They will remain out of our reach in this course. All the same, they do form a well-conceivable example of the kind of concepts that we shall explore in the upcoming episodes. What we see here in front of us are distributions of something, of water, energy and momentum in this case. Quantities are distributed in space, and these very distributions evolve over time. In physics and applied mathematics, the notion of a distributed, possibly dynamic quantity is captured by the concept of fields. What we see here, stretching out in front of us, is a wave field. As far as differential equations are concerned, this is the domain of partial differential equations.
In this episode, we shall start exploring a new subject, that is partial differential equations. So we will focus on linear equations again. There's a little bit of a different flavor here as compared to the ordinary linear differential equations that we studied so far. That is, for the ordinary differential equations, we had the existence and uniqueness theorem for initial value problems, and that formed the basis to get a grasp of what the general solution of a given linear differential equation was like. And then we worked a lot on finding fundamental solutions, so a basis that spans the general solution of the ordinary linear differential equations that we studied. For partial differential equations, we will follow a somewhat more pragmatic approach. We will start looking for solutions in the first place, and then start building and build wider and wider classes of solutions. But there will be no fundamental basis that we on which basis of which we could claim that we have found a general solution of the most wide class of all possible solutions of these partial differential equations. Well, now let's just dive into this and see how this will develop. So we'll have a brief introduction, partial differential equations, giving some motivation. I said the theory is not very general, but it is really focused on applications. So I think that is good news. And then we will proceed by some case studies. I will just follow the textbook here. And the first case that we will study is the so-called heat equation. And I will explain what it means, where it comes from, how to construct that. And then we will just start looking for solutions by a technique called separation of variables. And I will explain how to perceive that as we go. So let's just get started and see where this brings us. As I said, we will study as a case the so-called heat equation, but I will study with a disclaimer. So heat is a physical phenomenon. It is understood to be the thermal energy on the move, so energy on transport, and transport mechanisms known for transport of heat include convection, so that has to do with the motions of fluid, and heat energy transported along with it. And we have, of course, the well-known radiation, that is the heat that you feel from the sun, that is radiation that travels to you from the sun through the vacuum. And then there's diffusion, and that is in orange here. Now, what is known as the heat equation, what is called the heat equation in the textbook, covers only the diffusion mode of transport of heat. In practice, that is likely the dominant transport mechanism in solids, where the solid is not able to move, so there could be no convection. And also radiation is not a very likely transport mechanism inside solids. So the transport of heat through solid is likely diffusion. And I suggest that the diffusion equation might be a better name for the equation that we will study. And that actually also applies to diffusive transport of matter, for example, mixed gases or dissolved chemicals. Now, this slide gives a kind of a context. So the first equation that we have in the list over here at the right, this one, that is the heat equation. That is the first partial differential equation that we will study. And for comparison, I also show the wave equation. It looks very similar, but you see in the heat equation, we have U subscript T. And in the wave equation, we have double subscript T. And you might remember from calculus, and that also applies in this course, subscript T means partial derivative with respect to T. Just as a reminder, partial derivative with respect to T means that if U is a function of two variables, say X and T, if we take the partial derivative with respect to T, we consider X to be a constant, and vice versa. The subscripts X over here mean derivative with respect to X, keeping all other variables constant, so considering them to be as if they were constants while you take that derivative. That is the meaning of partial derivatives. So this equation over here contains partial derivative with respect to T twice with respect to X, and this is the double derivative with respect to Y, etc. So this is what a heat equation looks like, and I will derive it in a minute to explain what it really means. And this is a wave equation that we will study later, and I already mentioned now that there's a fundamental difference between heat transport and wave transport. So heat tends to spread out, and waves by the term a wave, we denote physical phenomena where there's transport, but the shape of the distribution tends to travel as a whole. So there's a fundamental difference, and apparently that has to do with the order of the derivative with respect to time. But that is something that we will meet while we study these differential equations in the course of the coming episodes. Now, and then lastly, there is this equation. It's called Poisson's equation. That is actually the Laplace operator at the left side. So double derivative with respect to x plus double derivative with respect to y, double derivative with respect to z, all that added. That is the Laplace operator acting on the function u. If you consider that as a function of Cartesian coordinates x, y, and z. So that would be the divergence of the gradient of u, actually. But we will meet that in a minute. Because as you see, this Laplace operator plays a role in all the three equations. So in the heat equation, it is here. And in the wave equation, it is over there. So you could say this potential equation, the third one, is actually kind of describes a stationary state, actually, of heat. If you would consider a function u that does not depend on t, you substitute it here, you get this potential equation with zero on the right hand side. See? So those are closely related, but we will learn more about it in the coming episodes. So as I already indicate, the partial differential equations address functions that are function of multiple variables. You could conceive that in this case, for example, as x, y, z being Cartesian coordinates of space, and t, the coordinate of time, the time. So we conceive these fields u as really fields distributions in space that also evolve over time. So we really enter now applications to fields that occur in physics. And indeed, many laws, the fundamental laws of physics, come to us in the form of partial differential equations. So we are really very close to application now. And you can interpret them as describing balances between spatial variations. So those are the derivatives with respect to the spatial coordinates. You could think of curvatures in various directions. And changes over time. So the derivative over time, that would be in the time direction, the slope of the function u. And all that added up must make a balance. That is, if you add it all up, you get a right-hand side that is zero here. So these two equations, as everything in the left-hand side added up, must make up to a balance zero. And in the third equation, we allow a prescribed function rho at the right-hand side, which then we call a source term. So there's a forcing for that field. That would be a given function that prescribes what the outcome of the Laplacian operator on the left-hand side should be. All right, and in the lower green box here again, we have what I mentioned, the meaning of partial derivative and the notation by a subscript that we will use meet in the textbook, and both have their advantages and disadvantages, maybe. So I will use them in an interchangeable way. Well, now let's have a look at the heat equation to have some focus and some interpretation of what partial differential equations are about, what they bring us. But here's a derivation on one slide. So we conceive heat in physics as something that has in some sense is quantitative. So you could talk about if I have some arbitrary box cube here selected in space, then I could talk about the total amount of heat energy, and assuming that that is conserved, so we exclude the thermodynamic processes that produce heat, so we assume that the total amount of heat is conserved, then the reasoning is that the total amount of heat can then be calculated, and it could decrease. So the total amount of heat in that cube can only decrease if some heat escapes through the walls. That is the whole idea of conservation. The amount can only decrease if it escapes, like the amount of money in your wallet can only decrease if you spend some money. So that is the reasoning. It's really bookkeeping that we are doing here. So there we go. There's a couple of quantities defined in physics that help us to calculate the amount of heat. So we have rho here. That's a different rho, by the way, from the one that is on the previous slide. But here rho is mass density. So that is amount of mass per volume, the kilograms per cube meter, for example. And if we multiply that by a property of solids, of property of materials that is called specific heat, that would be the energy per temperature unit and per mass unit. So if we multiply energy per mass unit by mass unit per volume, so I would get energy per temperature unit per volume unit. And if we multiply that by temperature, you apparently get energy per volume unit. So this combination is the energy per volume unit. And I multiply that by a volume element, so I get energy. And if I integrate that over a full given volume, that might be that blue cube, then apparently this would give me the total amount of heat energy in that cube. And then if I take the partial derivative of that, that would give me the increase, actually, of the total amount of heat stored in that cube. And then by adding a minus sign, I get the decrease. So this expression calculates the decrease per second, say per time unit. This gives the decrease per time unit of the total amount of heat stored in that cube. And then, as I just discussed, the heat can only decrease if it escapes through the walls. And then we use another property that is kappa here. That's called the heat conductivity. That is a property of materials again, and that says the flux of heat, so the rate with which heat flows, is proportional to the temperature gradient. So this is the gradient operator. It acts on a temperature distribution. So this will be a vector field that points in the direction of the strongest increase of the temperature, if you remember from my calculus. And otherwise, this is a good moment to refresh your knowledge about what gradient is. So there will be a vector field pointing everywhere in the direction of the increase of heat, and it gives the rate of increase of heat per length unit. Now, so this is the temperature gradient, and proportional to that we have this heat flow. So heat flow is really driven by a temperature gradient, and there's a minus here because we conceive that heat flows from high temperatures to low temperatures. So the heat flow, that is this combination, is opposite to the gradient of the temperature. The heat flow is opposite to the gradient of the temperature, that is this minus. So this would calculate the heat flow on every point, and now we integrate it, the amount of that, the flux of that through these walls. Now that is this integral, that is the integral over the surface surrounding that cube, so over all sides of the component of the heat flow that is normal to the cube. And this is again the flux integral as it was as it was covered in the calculus courses. Now, and then we can apply calculus. We can say, well, if we have a gradient, if we have a vector field, this is a vector field, and we integrate the normal component of that over a closed surface, then the result by Gauss's theorem is that we may calculate that by integrating the divergence of that same field over the volume. That is Gauss's theorem that we apply here. And then here's one more assumption, step 5. If you assume that that constant kappa is a material constant and the materials are homogeneous, then it is reasonable to assume that kappa will be a constant as a function of space. So it will be constant with respect to all the partial derivatives that are in this divergence, and then I can take it out and I get the divergence of the gradient of the temperature. And a shorthand for that is the Laplacian operator, the nabla squared down here. So this is really the basic assumption that heat is conserved. So if it decreases in a volume, total amount of heat in the volume decreases, then it must be equal to the flux of the heat through the walls outside. Or if the flux is inwards, then the heat will increase. And furthermore, we have some material properties. And here's the statement that the heat flux is driven by temperature gradients. So that is the basic physics that is captured by these differential equations, and the rest is calculus. That is the basic techniques from the calculus courses. Now, so let's copy the result over here. So this at the top, the decrease of the heat content is equal to the Laplacian of the temperature field. And both are now integrated over volumes, thanks to our application of Gauss's theorem. And thanks to that, we can combine these integrals. So I would take these to the right and get rid of this minus signal. And divide by S times rho here. So I get a combination of these material coefficients. And this minus the Laplacian is over here. And everything is integrated over a volume. Now we realize that the volume that I chose, that blue cube, was rather arbitrary. It was just some blue cube that I picked in space, and I applied the reasoning to that. But that reasoning would be valid for any volume that we would select. So this volume over here that we are integrating over is actually arbitrary, and the relation should hold for any volume that we conceive in the physical space that we apply our reasoning to. Any arbitrary volume. So for any arbitrary volume, this integral should vanish, and that can be so only if actually the argument of that integral is zero. That is the only way in which such an integral over any arbitrary value should always be zero. It can only be if the argument of the integral is zero. Now and then we follow the textbook and say, well, we call this combination of parameters alpha squared over here, and substitute that, you get this equation. And I write out in detail here. We write out in detail this Laplacian operator, which was the divergence of the gradient. If you write that in Cartesian rectangular coordinates, you get this. So that is the interpretation and foundation of our, what is called a heat equation, which is this actually a diffusion equation. You have a gradient that drives a transport and the total quantity that you study, that is here denoted by U, where you consider to be conserved. So the same reasoning would apply to, for example, salt as dissolved in water, as long as you consider that salt as conserved, so there should not be chemical processes that eat away the salt or something. But as long as that is the case, and the diffusion is driven by gradients of the salt going from higher concentration to lower concentration, exactly the same reasoning applies. So diffusion equation would be a good name for this, because that is the process that we captured by the reasoning. So we have an equation and we have some interpretation, and that should motivate us to go and look for solutions. So here we go. Well, as I said, the situation is a little bit different than what it was in ordinary differential equations. But it is inspired by it. So with ordinary differential equations, we had the experience that ordinary differential equations had a general solution, that is the set of all possible functions that satisfy the differential equation. We don't have theorems that provide us with such a notion here for the partial differential equations, but thinking back about the ordinary differential equations, when we did have a general solution, it was spanned by a set of fundamental solutions. So we looked for a y1 and a y2, and then we formed all the linear combinations of those, and that spanned the general solution of the ordinary differential equation. Well, why not try to apply the same idea here, without having the notion of a general solution, but let us just try to find at least some non-trivial solutions of that heat equation that we are working on, so that linear partial differential equation, and then make linear combination of those solutions that we find to build more general ones and see where we get. By the way, I just mentioned that the heat equation is a linear equation. That is kind of obvious, because there's no products of U or derivatives of U involved. But if you are doubtful about that, just check it for yourself. So linearity is, you assume that you have two solutions, form a linear combination of that, substitute it in the equation, and show that the linear combination then again is a solution. So that is quite straightforward to check. So if you are in doubt, just do that for yourself. That is a very good exercise then at this moment. But it is, the heat equation is a linear equation. So so the superposition principle applies, and that is really the fundamental principle that we will explore and that we will use to generate as many different solutions as we can. But we start with that plan in mind. We now start looking for at least some non-trivial solutions. So any solution that we will find, we will be we will celebrate for the moment and then proceed while we go. That is the style of working for this subject as we do it. So here's the equation again that we will study, and let's have a look at it. Well, the first thing that we notice is all these different directions, all these different partial directions, partial derivatives. But if we would assume that the temperature would not actually depend on the y and z directions, but the temperature would only vary in the x direction, then these derivatives would be zero. So that would be simpler. And we allow ourselves now, because we are only starting to work on partial differential equations, let's simplify the problem and focus on that one in the green box. So we assume that u only depends on temperature and on the spatial x direction. Now, if we look at that, we see at one side the derivatives with respect to x, and the other side derivatives with respect to t, and those are partial derivatives. And that means if we take the partial derivative with respect to t, we may assume that anything in u that depends on x is constant. And vice versa, if we take the derivative with respect to x, we may assume that any function that would be in any occurrence in u of t would be considered to be a constant as long as we are working on taking that partial derivatives with respect to x. That means that if there would be a factor in u depending on x, we could move that through that partial derivative with respect to t. It would be a constant, and a constant can be moved through the derivative. Now, and vice versa for derivatives with respect to x, those would be transparent for factors that depend on t. Now, that gives inspiration to look for solutions of the form like in the lower green box. So we say u will be a function of x and t, but we hope to find solutions that can be written as a product. So one factor that depends only on x times another factor that depends only on t. So mind you, again, we are not expecting to find very interesting general solutions that are of this form, but we will be glad to find any solution, and we will use those solutions that we will find as building blocks, using the superposition principle to make more wider classes of solutions. So any solution that we find will be we will celebrate, and we start looking for these because of that reasoning that I just discussed. That these derivatives will be transparent for these factors. So let's see. So if you do substitute such a factorized form into this differential equation that we have, indeed, you get the second order derivative with respect to x here, but t can be written in front of that, can be taken through the derivative, and on the other side we are left to the partial derivative of this t with respect to t times that function capital X that is supposed to depend only on the variable x. And then the next step is that you can divide by u itself, actually, so by x times t. And that will transform 2 into what is in this green box, numbered 3. So 1 over x, second order derivative of x, will be equal to 1 over alpha squared t of t. That goes over there, that goes over there. Derivative of t with respect to t. And then the reasoning is that here we have an equation that says these... at the left-hand side, we have a function that will depend on x. If it doesn't, it is of no interest, and it will just be zero, and we don't find any interesting solution whatsoever. So we envision that left-hand side to be an interesting function of x, and a right-hand side is an interesting function of t. And those must be equal. Now, the only functions that are functions of x that can equal functions that are functions of t, and those are independent variables, are the constant functions. So the conclusion is then, if we can expect anything interesting to come out of this, we must assume that the left-hand side is a constant, actually, the constant function of x, and the right-hand side is a constant function of t, and those constant values must be equal. So that is the conclusion in green over here. What is in the green box can only be true if both sides are actually constant functions, and the constant values that they take must be equal. And the notation that I use for that is like this. It is this combination denotes a constant. So if you conceive beta to be a real number, then beta squared will be positive. And I've added this plus or minus sign, that is to emphasize that in what is coming, we will constantly be aware of what the sign of that constant is. If you would just write c, can be constant, that constant can be positive, negative, or zero. But it is very important to make clear distinction between the signs, because that has consequences in what is coming. So I have a very explicit notation for this separation constant to emphasize that you will be involved in making choices for that sign to select scenarios of what will happen as a consequence of that choice. So to navigate your way through the possibilities that we will meet. That is the reason for this somewhat creative notation for the constant. Now, the separation is successful here for the heat equation. In general, it is possible because in the original differential equation, so the heat equation here, the prefactors that we had of the derivatives themselves can be written as in terms of factors depending on either only x or either only t. And in this case, that is trivial because the constants, the prefactors are all constants. But this approach, separation of variables, is not guaranteed to work for any partial differential equation that you would write down. But it does usually work with respect to space and time in physics. And that is because in applications we usually concentrate on laws of physics. And then the coefficients that of such time derivatives are usually not space dependent, and vice versa, the spatial dependencies, if you concentrate on the real fundamental physical laws, those laws usually apply anywhere. So the coefficients usually do not depend on space. So as a consequence of the fact that the physical laws form the application domain of this field of partial differential equations. Because the physical laws usually apply anywhere in space and anywhere in time in the same way. So the physical laws do not change over time themselves. That means that usually these coefficients that you have are usually constants. And that explains the success of the separation of variables in practice. And as we will see, as regards to spatial coordinates like x and y, in curvilinear coordinates like spherical coordinates or cylindrical coordinates or polar coordinates, the same technique applies, and it is usually possible to separate differential equations in factors that depend only on the radius, and another factor depends only on, let's say, latitude or longitude, as I briefly mentioned when we discussed that application to the gravitational field of Jupiter. Laplacian can be taken apart in factors depending only on radius, latitude or longitude. It is the same technique. So you would have three factors, r of r, theta of theta, phi of phi, say. Substitute in the Laplacian in spherical coordinates, and then the scenario is the same. You can take it apart in, as we see. So the next step, if we have proceeded so far as three, then the conclusion is that actually, because we assume that both sides are constants, constant function of x, constant function of t, with the same value for the constant, what you see happening if you write that down in the green box here, you see that you get two ordinary differential equations that are coupled by that constant. So they are not independent, but both are ordinary differential equations with only, and I make one more step, just multiplying by x of x here, I get the result in the right-hand green box that the second order derivative of my function capital X that depends only on X with respect to X is proportional to X itself with a constant that is still labeled as plus or minus beta squared. And same for the function T of T. So the derivative, partial derivative, you might also write an ordinary derivative, but in, as far as we have proceeded, those functions depend only on time, so the distinction between the partial derivative and the ordinary derivative is now no longer relevant. But the derivative of that function capital T of T with respect to T is would just be proportional to T. So now we observe that we have actually two linear operators again, second order derivative with respect to x, this one, and the derivative with respect to t, both are linear operators acting on something, and no worse happens to that something according to these equations than that they are multiplied by a number. So that brings to mind the concept that we already discussed when we discussed Euler's equation, and as a stepping stone towards that, I briefly covered linear ordinary differential equations with constant coefficients, and then the connection between those was that both could be interpreted in terms of eigenfunctions of their building blocks. The methods that we developed to solve those equations could be interpreted as working with eigenfunctions. And now here again, if we have a partial differential equation and we successfully apply the method of separations of variables, then what happens is that we take the partial differential equation apart into ordinary differential equations, and those take the form of eigenvalue problems. And So these constants, the separation constants that we that surfaced in our process, and that I chose to write as plus or minus beta squared, this combination, as I emphasized, and as I emphasize here again, the signs of these are yet free to be chosen, and those are the eigenvalues of these problems. So let's see, that is now the next item that we will focus on, what do the solutions of those eigenvalue problems look like. And I present it as a kind of an intermezzo. So we started solving partial differential equations and kind of came up with this strategy to separate variables, and now we run into eigenvalue problems. And now I have an intermezzo that we study those, we focus on those for a minute, and then return to the main line of the story, the partial differential equations later on. So eigenfunctions of differential operators. Here it is again, the equation that we are looking into. You can write it in different ways. So we arrived at it in terms of partial differential notation, but x is the only variable, so we might also write, as I already mentioned, the ordinary ordinary derivative with respect to x twice, or even use the double prime notation. But these notations, either this one or that, emphasizes the structure that you have a linear operator acting on something, and it, according to this equation, no worse should happen to that something, that as a result of this, that something is just multiplied by a number. Now, again, that is very much the same structure as the eigenvalues that were covered in the linear algebra course, where usually the linear operator was represented by a matrix and it acted on a vector, and no worse if such a vector is called an eigenvector of that matrix, of that linear operation, if no worse happens as a result of this, then that vector is just scaled by a number. It is for vectors that you would depict by arrows, that would mean just that the vector is just changed in length, but not in direction. So those were the eigenvalue problems in linear algebra, and the structure that we meet here is very much the same. And solutions of such a problem are called eigenfunctions of that operator that you have on the left hand side, so the double derivative with respect to x in this case. Operator ddx squared, eigenvectors of that, eigenvectors are denoted as eigenfunctions. Now, what are they? Here's an overview, and I strongly recommend to just learn this by heart. So in an exam situation, if you meet an eigenvalue problem for ddx squared, you are not going to solve it from scratch. You just know what eigenvalues are of this operator, and here's the table, there's the complete overview. So learn this by heart and just apply it when you need it in practice, and also at the exam, but also in engineering practice. This is such a fundamental result, and such a fundamental ingredient of science and applied sciences and engineering. You just know this and proceed according to that knowledge if you ever meet this. I dare say this is the very reason why you learned about exponential functions and sines and cosines calculus, and maybe even in high school in the first place, because they are the eigen functions of these operators. And that's clear, isn't it? So if we take the derivative of an exponential function, that just gives that exponential functions times this k, and if you do it twice, you get k squared as a prefactor. And actually, if you do that, if you take the derivative with respect to x of exponential functions of minus kx twice, you also get k squared, so minus k times minus k, twice the chain rule. Twice the chain rule, minus k is also k squared, positive. So we see the exponential, we have two exponential functions of kx and of minus kx, that both are eigenfunctions of this operation, both with eigenvalue k squared, which we take to be positive because we conceive this number as a real number. Now, the same operator also has eigenfunctions, namely the sine and the cosine functions. So if omega x, if you take the derivative twice of the sine, you get sine, cosine, minus sine, and multiply it twice by omega on the way because of the chain rule again. So then the eigenvalue would be minus omega squared, and that is negative. See? So now that is what I had in mind when I choose my notation, emphasizing the sign of the eigenvalues. It matters a lot. If you decide on the sign that the eigenvalue should have, if it should be positive or negative, you get a rather different class of eigenfunctions with different behaviors. Exponential functions have this steep exponential growth, and these oscillate. That is very different. And it depends on the sign of the eigenvalue. So here we have positive ones and negative ones, and in the middle of that is eigenvalue exactly zero. And we think about it. If you would say what is eigenfunctions of the double derivative acting on a function is zero, then it just says that the curvature of the function is zero, and those are the straight lines. So straight lines, ax plus b, we can take as the eigenfunctions of this operator with eigenvalue zero. So recall my remark again, and I emphasized it also in the slides in this orange warning box. Sign matters. If you are navigating through problems with partial differential equations, you make your choices which eigenvalues to explore in which context. Choosing the sign decides with what kind of spatial behavior you get. Do you get exponential explosive growth, or very rapid decay to zero and explosive growth in the other direction, or do you get oscillating functions that have multiple zeros? These have no zeros by themselves. So there you can find, as we will see in the applications that you will have in mind, you will find criteria for selecting, for going after certain classes of eigenfunctions, and you can navigate and adjust the functions that you get by focusing on the sign of the eigenvalues. So keep that in mind. This is an overview of the eigenfunctions of that operator ordered by the sign of their eigenvalues, positive, negative, and the special case of eigenvalue zero. Yeah, and then another interesting property that you might remember from linear algebra, that you should remember from linear algebra, eigenvectors that have the same eigenvalue for my linear subspace. That means if I have two eigenfunctions here, and I make a linear combination, and these do have the same eigenvalue, then all these linear combinations, so the span of these two eigenfunctions actually forms a subspace. So all these linear combinations are also eigenfunctions with the same eigenvalue. And an interesting one is this one. The hyperbolic sine and the hyperbolic cosine functions are actually the even and the odd parts of the exponential functions. So this hyperbolic sine, so if you put half and minus half here, you would get the hyperbolic sine function. And if you put half plus half, if you would choose a half or b half, you get the hyperbolic cosine function. Those are interesting and very practical functions. They are also they're each other's derivative, for example. So I recommend, I mentioned it very briefly, but I recommend to either work it out for yourself as using what I just said, or somehow look up these functions and learn about them. Those are very practical to have in your toolbox when working with the partial differential equations that we shall work with. And same here, so the sine and the cosine were the eigenfunctions of this operator with negative eigenvalues, and all the linear combinations of them are also eigenfunctions with the very same eigenvalue. And now that we talk about it, you might notice that this is already intuitively, I came up with these strange straight lines, but they are already a linear combination of the function x and the constant function 1 here. So this is already a linear combination of two functions, the function x and 1, that each of for themselves are eigenfunctions with eigenvalue 0 for this one. So this one, just by freestyle inspiration, already came in the form of a linear combination, as we have it now here. Now, and then the other operator, ddt, that we had also in a partial differential operator, and that provided us also with an eigenvalue problem. And that has the following eigenfunctions. So the exponential function, if you take the derivative of that, due to the chain with respect to t, due to the chain rule, just gets multiplied by k, and that can be conceived as an eigenfunction then. So an exponential kt is the eigenfunction of the ddt operator with eigenvalue k. And that can have all signs. So whatever sign you choose, you always get the exponential function. And an exception is to be emphasized, the constant function, but that is also what you get here if you choose k equal to 0. Actually, the exponential of 0 is 1, and then by multiplying it by any so that would be a eigenfunction, and you can multiply it by any number, you get another eigenfunction with the same eigenvalue because of the linearity again. So this case I mentioned separately, but it is sort of included in the top box already. That is good to have in mind, because as I said, in partial differential equations we will navigate our way in the situation, and it's good to have these kind of ideas in your toolbox. All right. So that's how far we got with this outline. So we started just brief summary, and then I think we should call it an episode and let all these ideas sink in, and then we proceed with this next time. So we stirred up a lot of new ideas. I introduced the partial differential equations, we discussed the notation, and then I discussed some motivation, and I discussed what you can expect in terms of the style of working that we shall meet in this topic. And then I rather extensively discussed the foundation and derivation of the heat equation to give a real meaning to it, to understand and to get a feeling for why we are working on these kind of problems in the first way, and to have some idea of what it is about. And then we just started looking for solutions, kind of inspired the way of pushing forward and see if we can find any solution at all with a plan in mind that the differential equation that we are looking into is a linear equation. So check that for yourself. So linear equation, so we do have the superposition principle. We have not used it yet, but that is the plan for next time. With that in mind, we started focusing on looking for separable solutions. So solutions that can be written as a factor of, in this case, the function only depending on x, that we indicated by capital X. Another function only depending on t, that we indicated by capital T. Substituted, and then we discovered that the partial differential equation falls apart into eigenvalue problems that are coupled by the fact that they have common eigenvalues. And hence we started exploring eigenfunctions, and we made an overview for those two operators that we met, the double derivative with respect to x and the double derivative with respect to t. I presented a table that you should recognize because all those functions are standard functions. And I suggested the very fact that you know about those functions is really that they are eigenfunctions of these operators. That is why they play such an important role in all kinds of applications. And we discussed an overview of that, stressing that it really depends on the sign of the eigenvalue, which kind of behavior that you get for the eigenfunctions. So I strongly recommend to really learn that by heart, so that you have it in your toolbox and can apply it immediately if you meet this kind of sub-problems in when working on the partial differential equations. All right, now I would say we have stirred up enough new ideas. I really think that we deserve a break to let this sink in, and then we continue next time. So I call this an episode.